have the expectation that B will follow A. This is not a memory, nothing's changed. It is a change of instances. It's similar to Bergson and his clock. Tick, tock, tick, tock, tick, tock. Where repetition involves a relationship between two parts, and here repetition forms a new generality, and a supposition is formed that tock will follow tick. And we are made up of habits, contractions and relaxations, and the repetition of our beating hearts. We perform no more consciously than nature, the cycle of the seasons, the ebb and flow of the tides, and the rising and setting of the sun. And nature performs thus because it can. In the third book of physics, Euripides, Aristotle's disciple, said, some people accept and some people deny that time repeats itself. Repetition is understood in different senses. One kind of repetition may be the natural order of things, like repetition of summers and winters and other seasons, when a new one comes after another has disappeared. To this order of things belongs the movements of heavenly bodies and the phenomena produced by them, such as solstices and equinoxes, which are produced by the movement of the sun. Deleuze's argument proceeds through three models of time and relates to the concept of repetition of each of them. The first is time as a circle. Circular time is mythical and seasonal time, the repetition of the same after time has passed through its cardinal points. These points may be a simple natural repetition like the sun rising daily, the movements of the sun to spring, or the element of tragedy, which Deleuze suggests operates cyclically. There is a sense of both destiny and theology in the concept of time, as a circle, as a succession of instances which are governed by the eternal laws. Each rotation round the circle represents the reenactment of the succession of instances as a complete unit. I'm missing some of my slides. And the stories of Sisyphus were born out of this generality. As the people of Corinth worshipped the sun god Tetzel, who daily rolled the sun up and down the mountain that overshadows the landscape of the kingdom founded and ruled by Sisyphus. Passive Sisyphus constitutes our habit of living, our expectation that it will continue, that one or two elements will appear after the other. In the myth of Sisyphus, discussing suicide, Camus tells us, in a man's attachment to life, there is nothing stronger than all the ills in the world. The body's judgment is as good as the mind's, and the body shrinks from annihilation. We get into the habit of living before acquiring the habit of thinking. And to be clear, it is the mind that contemplates and witnesses these actions of habit, and sees and notes the repetitions it perceives. In this sense, repetition is imaginary, and in fact, true repetition takes place in the imagination. So, if we consider that habit is something, is somehow the foundation of time, the life of the past and present, the passing of the present into the past, the memory is that which causes the present to pass. It appears that the past is a relation of two presents, the present that has been and the current present. However, the former present has been reformed, as it ceases to be a happening event and is created in the mind as a resemblance of a former present. The present alone exists and includes both the past and the present. Every sign is a sign of the present from the point of view of the passive synthesis in which past and future are precisely only dimensions of the present itself. A scar is a sign not of the past wound, but of the present fact of having been wounded. The mind compartmentalizes the past event and forms it into a separate entity, a captured experience to be filed away in the brain, a memory that is now recreated as an event that was and is now past. As opposed to two successive instances, the present and the former present, the actual present contains an extra element of representing the former and itself. It includes the reflections of the current present with the memory of the former present. Therefore, difference occurs as the past present represents itself, and the present represents both the past and the present. The event of this was, and the new expression of the past event reflected in the present. The mind recalls the former event when a present event resembles the past event in the memory, and the brain recognizes at least this as a replication or a repetition. The memory forms essentially an identity to the past event, an identity that is then recognized in the present event, that is, the present represents both the former and itself. The synthesis involves reproduction and reflection, remembrance and recognition, memory and understanding. Sisyphus has become identified with repetition and futility. His fate is compared to the monotonous, repetitious 9-to-5 work day life of present man. He is remembered as we compare our present lives with his fate. Quote, rising, tram, 4 hours in the office or factory, meal, tram, 4 hours, and Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday and Saturday according to the same rhythm. Repetition and memory can be seen almost like a reminiscence, a saving of the past for ourselves as the mind forms and stores the event. It becomes a present that never was, as it takes on its meaning, its own meaning, to be brought forward in the present and remembered in different ways. The classical reception history of Sisyphus demonstrates this by presenting the multiplicity of ways that the core meaning of the myth has been reinterpreted. Reception history can be understood in the paradox of coexistence. All the past coexists with the present in relation to which it is now past. The past becomes the already there. If the repetition of habit can be seen as a circle and a chain of instances that appear in the present, then that of memory can be viewed as a line and presents the present and the present past. Memory can be seen as a repetition along a linear timeline, or perhaps as a succession of parallel lines, like the idea of the multiverse, the same story but at different levels. Sisyphus' freedom lies in choosing the level. Moreover, what we say of a life may be said of several lives, since each is a passing present. One life may replay another at a different level, as if the philosopher and the pig, the criminal and the saint, played out the same past at different levels of a gigantic poem. Each chooses his pitch of the tone, perhaps even his lyrics, but the tune remains the same. The lines become thicker and thicker as it proceeds up forwards, expanding as the new is added to everything that has come before. The pure past memory arranges the order of the present in a circle according to their decreasing or increasing resemblance to the idea, the memory, thus producing the effect of a cone. That which is being is what will be, and that which is done is what will be done, and there is nothing new under the sun. The ideas of habit of memory, present and past, include ideas of the future and often simplify the notion of repetition, and one becomes caught up in the trap of reminiscences. A key part of Sisyphus' punishment resides in its eternal nature, and a line or a circle are inadequate. Ideas of the future suggest time unfolding and ceases to be containable within these forms, as beginning and end no longer coincide. A fissura is created that constitutes a fracture in the circle, and the circle is undone. The present is implicated in both past and future, and together they represent a totality of time. And we know that future exists because of causation, for the fact that April showers caused May flowers. Normally, when cause occurs, these effects are not yet present. Eternal return is a belief in the future. It is the third repetition. It is the act that is repeated for the future. The Pythagorean Simplius of Seneca wrote, "The Pythagoreans said that the same things were repeated again and again, that there is another kind of repetition in quantity, in which the same thing exists a number of times. That means that I shall talk to you and sit exactly like this, and that I shall have in my hands the same stick, and everything will be the same as it is now. This makes it possible to suppose that there exists no difference in time, because its movements or heavenly bodies and many other things are the same. What occurred before and what will occur afterwards are always the same." Influenced by the work of Schopenhauer, Nietzsche first refers to eternal return in his book The Gay Science. Eternal return posits that the universe is recurring and will continue to recur an infinite number of times, and that this life as you now live it and have lived it, you will have to live it once more and innumerable times more, and there will be nothing new in it, but every pain and every joy and every thought and every sigh and everything unutterably small or great in your life will have to return to you. All is the same succession and sequence. Schopenhauer has suggested that the resolution to man's fear of death was perhaps the idea that the course of his life he had hitherto experienced, it should be of endless duration or of constant recurrence, but ultimately recognised, perhaps, no one at the end of their life, if they were simultaneously enlightened and honest, would wish to live their life over again. In fact, would prefer complete non-existence to it. In order to endure the horrifying thought of eternal return, Nietzsche said we must gain freedom from morality, that there must be a revaluation of values. To endure the idea of recurrence, one needs freedom from morality, new means against the fact of pain. Pain conceived as a tool, as the father of pleasure, there is no cumulative consciousness of displeasure. The enjoyment of all kinds of uncertainty and experimentalism, as a counterweight to this extreme fatalism, abolition of the concept of necessity, abolition of the will, abolition of knowledge in itself. Something that perhaps Sisyphus understood. Sisyphus must try to face each cycle of his punishment by looking for the difference in each repetition, the shift of meaning behind what he does. Deleuze believed that all repetition contains difference. The only thing that returns or is repeated is the power of difference. Sisyphus's reenactment can be seen, according to Deleuze's theory, as a way of seeing the same act in different ways. Although the actions remain the same, virtue can become determination, eternity is constant purpose, futility is endeavour. The act of pushing the boulder up the mountain only to witness it tumbling down again without ever hope of reaching summit becomes an act of becoming, a true becoming, as it has no end. The idea that eternal return has a mathematical possibility can be found in the work of Heinrich Heine. He said that if time is infinite, but the things in time, the concrete bodies, are finite, now, however, long time may pass, according to the eternal laws governing the combination of the eternal play of repetition, all configurations that have previously existed on this earth must yet meet, attract, repulse, and kiss, and corrupt each other again. Nietzsche echoed these thoughts in his book The Will to Power. If the world may be thought of as an act of, thought of as a certain definitive quantity of force, and as a certain definite number of centres of force, and every other representation remains indefinite and therefore useful, it follows that in the great dice game of existence, it must pass through a calculable number of combinations. In infinite time, every possible combination would at some time or another be realised. More, it would be realised in an infinite number of times. And since, between every combination and its next recurrence, all the other possible combinations would have to take place, and each of these combination conditions, the entire sequence of combinations in the same series, a circular movement of absolute identical series is thus demonstrated. The word is a circular movement that has already repeated itself infinitely often and plays its game ad infinitum. For Deleuze, eternal return is the royal repetition. The present is the repeater, the past is the repetition itself, and the future is that which is repeated. It is the reenactment of the theme of the three temporal stages, again and again. The ages of God, the Son, the Father, and the Holy Spirit, the ages of women, the maiden, the mother, and the crone, etc. It is the repeat of the repetition, the passing from past and present and into the future that creates eternal return. For Sisyphus and Deleuze, it is the fact that each cycle of repetition always creates a new experience, and through recognizable, and though recognizable by its resemblance to that which has gone before, each new present event brings with it new meaning and is therefore essentially different. Everything that exists only becomes and never is, and therefore can not really have a fixed identity, as it is always changing. Thus, it cannot be really identified with what has been. Sisyphus will always be at his task, he will never succeed and finish and is never stuck.